Good morning.
Good morning.
Let us start our service today by bowing our heads. Can't hear me? How about now? Okay. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day of being together and able to worship and praise you without the fear of persecution from others. We receive so many blessings from you, and time after time, we do not thank you. Open our hearts and minds to receive your messages, to follow your word, and be thankful for the things we have and not worry about what others have. Be with this congregation that we may leave the sanctuary. When we leave, we will be refreshed and revived by your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Just a few of the announcements that I'd just like to kind of bring up. I know they're in the bulletin. One of them, of course, is next week is Communion Sunday, Transfiguration. This month, we are doing heartbeats there for our mission giving. It is, they no longer have the bottles, they just have envelopes, and they're at both ends, one at the entrance from the front and from the sanctuary here. And then, of course, always remember to sign up on the calendar up in the fellowship hall for the fellowship hour for bringing just some snacks and then, of course, cleanup. Is there any other? Let the service begin.
Love that, Tracy. Thank you so much. So, blessed Lord's Day. Welcome to those who are present online and those who are present in the seats of the sanctuary, those who are present in their hearts in both ways. We're so glad that you're here to praise Jesus Christ, our Lord. I would ask us now to stand up, and in response, our call to worship is from Isaiah 40. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed, that her sin has been paid for, and that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God.
Every valley
shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain, and the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together. I call to your attention again the banner on the wall. We've heard this scripture preached throughout Advent and the beginning of this year. And now we begin our praise with our opening hymn in our scarlet hymnal, Hymns of Faith, 3259, Since Jesus Came Into My Heart. Let us sing with great joy for this happening. So if you came into the sanctuary sleepy and at all tired today, I think that woke us all up, and that's a good way to begin praising our Lord. Now we come to our time of confession, and it's based on the reading in the Old Testament in Genesis 5:6. Let us read together in unison. At a point in time, the Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. Forgive us when our hearts are not inclined toward your will. Praise the Lord that Jesus came into our heart. For we can receive the assurance of forgiveness, and together we respond. Hear the good news. Who is in the position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone. A new life has begun. Know you are forgiven and be at peace. Amen. Let us now call out for God's word in unison. Scripture cannot be set aside. What does Scripture say? And pray for the Holy Spirit to illumine the Scripture so that we might have understanding. Lord, through your Spirit, enable us to consider your word and to enact it in our lives to bring you glory and praise. Amen. Please be seated. We continue hearing the history of Jesus in his genealogy that followed his baptism. We are nearing the end. We have finished the biblical era of the patriarchs, and so we'll pick up from the reading in his genealogy that mentions the name of the patriarchs, and we're moving now to the biblical era of creation, the end of that era, which is the account of Noah. So hear the reading from Luke 3, and we begin at verse 34. The son of Jacob, the son of Isaac, the son of Abraham. The son of Terah, the son of Nahor, the son of Serug, the son of Reu, the son of Peleg, the son of Eber, the son of Shelah, the son of Canaan, the son of Arkaphad, the son of Shem, the son of Noah, the son of Lamech. And so, of course, we're going to turn to the account of Noah that comes near the end of the creation era in the Bible. But we're not going to go to the portion of the Noah's account that we know well. We know what happened with Noah. We know there was a flood. I'm wearing today a clergy stole that has all the animals on the ark. This is a story well known by children, but we're going to go before that point happens. We're going to open to actually Genesis chapter 5, verse 28, and then read partway into chapter 6. So this is on page 7 of your pew Bibles if you'd like to open it and read along as I read aloud. When Lamech had lived 182 years, he had a son. He named him Noah and said, "He will comfort us in the labor and painful toil of our hands caused by the ground the Lord has cursed." After Noah was born, Lamech lived 595 years and had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Lamech lived a total of 777 years, then he died. After Noah was 500 years old, he became the father of Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Continuing into chapter 6. When human beings began to increase in number on the earth, and daughters were born to them, the sons of God saw the daughters of humans were beautiful, and they married any of them they chose. Then the Lord said, "My spirit will not contend with humans forever, for they are mortal. Their days will be 120 years. The Nephilim were on the earth in those days and also afterwards. When the sons of God went to the daughters of humans and had children by them, they were the heroes of old, men of renown. The Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination and of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. The Lord regretted that he had made human beings on the earth, and his heart was deeply troubled. So the Lord said, "I will wipe from the face of the earth the human race I have created, and with them the animals, the birds, the creatures that move along the ground, for I regret that I have made them." But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This is another scripture, though, that when we say thanks be to God, when we really think about it, this is a story that we often teach to children. Cute little arks with lots of cute little animals. Nurseries are decorated with signs of this story. But think about what actually happens in the ark. What happens outside the ark, where the earth is destroyed. Humans are destroyed. The creatures are destroyed. It is not a story of comfort yet. Before this story began, before the ark was built, before Noah, who was held in favor, went into the ark, Lamech had a little baby boy, and his name was Noah. And he spoke over him, thinking about how cursed the ground was with the thorns and thistles and how much work it was and how the Lord had been the one to curse the earth. And he said, I will call him Noah because he will comfort us. That's our takeaway today. The verse, he will comfort us. So for a time, Noah was probably a comfort to his family. This may be even in our own families. My mom's online watching as she is week after week. This week I have been taking a course, actually, this last month, in older adult ministry, and this week we were focusing on the aspect of grieving the loss of loved ones and thinking about hardships and sufferings that we have, which includes losing loved ones that have died. That happened in the time of Noah. And when we lose our loved ones, people that we're close to, people that we're in relationship, sometimes the dynamics of our own lives can change. If we lose our children, all of our children, are we parents any longer? If we lose our spouses, are we any longer spouses? If we lose our parents, now we don't have them and we may become the matriarchs and patriarchs of the family. And it's all of these losses can be difficult and tempt us to think, have we lost our identity? And we need comfort. So my mother, God bless her, was a good daughter to her parents, as many of you have been to yours. She was there as their health decreased. She actually moved in with them to take care of my grandfather and my grandmother. What a wonderful role model for me to see a daughter. And I often ask my mother all the time, Mom, am I a good enough daughter to you? Because I saw how good she was to my grandparents, whom I loved and who treated me like gold. She was there for them. But then my grandfather died, my grandmother died, and it was really hard on my mom. If she was sitting here, I'd go, right, Mom? And she'd say, yeah. But she's online and she hears this. But the Lord brought a blessing during that time for her daughter, me, you've heard me talk about this, was told that I could not bear children. And so she thought, well, I don't know if I'll ever be a grandparent, though I did plan to adopt. But the Lord blessed me because at the time when my mother had lost her mother, I found out I was with child. And I could go to my mother, the desire of her heart, and say, hey, guess what, Mom? You're going to be a grandmother. Can you imagine the comfort that brought to my mother's heart and knowing that this desire of her heart would be fulfilled by the Lord? And we never thought it could happen, that it was possible, but the Lord granted it. So I think my mother understands the words of Lamech, of my oldest daughter. She will be a comfort to us. That's not an uncommon thing. However, consider the context of Noah. He was a comfort for a time to his family, but was Noah able to stop the flood? Was he able to stop the death that was going to come upon the earth? And of course, we all know the answer, no. He could take his own family, his wife, his children, his sons, his daughter-in-laws into the ark and be there safe so that when the flood ended, he could become the new creation like it talked about in our assurance of forgiveness. He began a new creation through his family. But was that a comfort to any of the people that knew him who were outside the ark? Think about it. Wasn't. Still, though we may not understand why has God decided to act in certain ways and we could just give the quick answer saying, because God is holy. But it still is hard for us to face sometimes the decisions of God. But we need to also realize that it's not people who are to be our comfort. You're all here, and I think you have friends who are here, who are comforts to you. Some of you are sitting here, husband and wife, family members, who are comforts to you. But as the scripture says, God will only contend with human beings to 120 years. How many of you know people who are 120 years old? There are some who make it to 100 or more, but we don't live longer than that. There are times where we all are going to suffer loss, and our loved ones who are comforts to us cannot be comfort 24/7 and through all of eternity. It is God who is to be the comfort to us. He's the only one who can fill all of our needs and all of our broken places. No one person can do that. No group of people, no church can do that. We are here not to worship each other or to be, yes, we have the benefit of social contacts, but this is to worship God who is our comfort. We were in Sunday school this morning, and we're studying the doctrine of God, the doctrine of the Father, the doctrine of Jesus Christ. Next week, we'll get to the doctrine of the Holy Spirit. And I realized, oh my goodness, why didn't I put this in the sermon? Because it was powerful. And I said to the class, I think I'm supposed to read it today. We have within our Constitution the Book of Confessions, which has creeds, short statements of faith. Confessions, long statements of faith. We learned the distinction between these, and catechisms. In the olden days, when kids or adults, anyone would want to come and join the church, there were dozens of questions about faith. And to become a member of the church, you had to be able to answer verbatim what it said in the Book of Confession for every question. Has anyone ever gone through a catechism? I did because I grew up Catholic. So I had to go through a catechism. Now, I tease our kids. I show the kids. We're going to start some confirmation classes. And I go, these catechisms are written. And they look at it and they go, we got to remember all that? And I said, no. I'm not going to make you do that. But there are certain ones that I want you to know. You don't have to know them verbatim, but this is one. The first catechism that is written is what's called the Heidelberg Catechism, written in Germany. And here's the question. I want you to think about this. It relates to what we're hearing in God's word today. What is your only comfort in life and death? Stop for a moment and answer that in your being. Is it your granddaughter? Is it your husband? Is it your mom? Is it your friend? Is it your church? Or is it the answer that is here? I'm going to read the whole. I don't require the kids to remember the whole. Listen to this with your heart, not your head. What is your only comfort in life and in death? That I am not my own. That I belong, body and soul, in life and in death, to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. So I asked the kids just to be able to remember to say this. When I ask, what is your only comfort in life and death? That I belong to Jesus Christ. And it expounds on this. He has fully paid for all my sins with his precious blood. And he has set me free from the tyranny of the devil. He also watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation because I belong to Him, Christ, by His Holy Spirit, assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for Him. Do I hear an amen? Amen. Our comfort in life and death is not Noah. It's not my daughter, Angela. My mother knows this. She is such a strong Christian. She raised me in the faith, and she gets stronger every day, and I'm proud to know her and to see her growing in Christ. But it's the Holy Spirit who brings us to Christ, so we can also turn to the scripture. Christ knew that He was not going to be with us, and He was going to ascend into heaven, and He was going to die and be resurrected and ascend into heaven. So He sat with the disciples before He died, and He prepared them in the final discourse in John 14 through 17. Love it. One of my favorite parts of scripture. And in John 14, He speaks of the Holy Spirit because the Holy Spirit is the one who draws us to Christ and makes Christ real to us, known to us, and therefore the Father known to us. And I'm actually going to start reading in a place a little earlier in this scripture. It's on page 1536 in your pew Bible, on John 14. I'm going to find exactly where I want to start. Okay. Verse 16 in John 14. Jesus is praying at the right hand of the Father. Now, what He prayed on earth. And I will ask the Father, and He will give to you another advocate. Stop there. Another advocate. Jesus is the advocate, but He'll give you another advocate because I'm going to be with the Father. You need someone right here with you now in times when you need comfort. Another word for advocate, counselor. Another word for counselor, my babies had blankies. The comforter. He will give you another comforter to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept Him because it neither sees Him nor knows Him, but you will know Him, for He lives with you and will be in you. One of my favorite verses. Mom, I know you lost your dad. I know you lost your mom. I lost my dad very young, and I don't want to lose my mom. But this is what Jesus says in verse 18. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you through the Spirit. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you will also live. And on that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. He continues in verse 25. All this I have spoken while I am still with you. But the advocate, the counselor, the comforter, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. When I read the question of the catechism this morning, I said, don't listen with your head, listen with your heart. "What do you feel, Jim? I hope you don't mind." And Jim said one word. He said, "Peace." "What is your only comfort in life and death?" "That I belong to Jesus Christ, and that through the Holy Spirit gives comfort and peace." Thanks be to God. Now we can say it. Ready? Thanks be to God. Amen. And with that, we stand and sing a favorite hymn of many in our hymns of faith. It sounds kind of slow and sad, not like our opening hymn, but it matches the watery language of the story of Noah. 223, "It is well with my soul, because I belong to Jesus Christ. He is my comforter and gives me peace." Please stand and sing. Amen. You may be seated. Corrie ten Boom, survivor of the Holocaust and World War II, has a saying, and I love this song because her saying reminds me of it. She says this, and we talked about this also in Sunday school, there is no well so deep that Jesus is not in it. There is no pit so deep that Jesus is not in it. So when people ask how we are, so oftentimes we'll say things like, yeah, I'm good, I'm okay. What if we got in the habit of saying, I am well? Let us go to God in prayer, thinking of all the ways that we are well because of Jesus. Let us pray and pray for the concerns that we want to lift up today. Though, Lord, not everything is well with the world. Certainly not. Certainly not. Because we belong to you, Jesus, we are well. We thank you and we lift up in great joy your name. Our purpose is to glorify you and to enjoy you forever because we belong to Jesus Christ, the greatest joy that we can claim. You are the one who gives us every other occasion of celebration too. Celebrating births, celebrating anniversaries, celebrating all the different steps that we take in life, upcoming graduations, weddings, whatever might be taking place. But you also, Jesus, sitting right next to the right hand of the Father, you pray for us. And you care about what is on our heart, what are our concerns. Our greatest concern should be, are we as the church living according to your will? Are we looking to your word for direction in everything that we do, think, say? Lord, if there's any part of us that is asleep, any part of us that just seems broken, heal us and revive us so that we will be a church of great witness for people who are out there struggling in darkness, who need to know that you are the answer, Jesus, and that the church, the bride of Christ, is the place where they can go and receive healing and ministry. And allow us to learn and grow and to be able to respond and to not turn away. Help us to show your love is real. Your presence is real. Christ, you are the living Son of God. We pray, Lord, for the whole of the world, for all of the nations, for all of the continents in this earth. We recognize that there are places that are so dark and broken where your name is hardly ever spoken, Jesus. We pray for them. We speak out your name. Speak it out now if you want. Just say, Jesus, Jesus, be with them. Be with them. Let them know who you are. Be with the missionaries and evangelists who are there, O Lord, for them to see the truth that you are the way, you are the truth, you are the life, the only way, the only truth, the only life, a way of love, a way of life. Lord, we pray for our nation, for times where we have turned away. We have turned away from your word, O Lord. We have turned away from your way. And not just as a nation, but there are parts of the church that have turned away. Turn us back. Help us to repent, O Lord, and to renounce the ways that we have turned away and to turn to you and you alone. We pray for leaders of the church, leaders of government, health, education, businesses. Lord, I thank you that we pray for businesses in this area. I thank you that you sent me to the bank this week and I met a manager there and I was able to say, we pray for you. We pray for you. And ask if he wanted prayer. He said, I always need prayer. Help us to be brave and to go forth because there's darkness out there. We need to pray. We pray for the first responders, for military, for EMTs, firefighters, and police officers that somehow nowadays are looked down upon. Lord, fix us, mend us, restore us. We pray for the Pataskala community, for children and youth and family of all sizes. We thank you for agencies that are established to help in the needs such as Heartbeats, who really understand and know it is necessary for us to live into the sanctity of life. We pray for great mercy for those who have not. We pray that sins will be confessed and that we as the church will be there to mend those places for people who have taken actions to destroy life. We pray for those who took actions against life and human trafficking, especially toward youth. We pray for Grace Haven. We pray for victims of natural disasters. We pray for those in grief who have lost loved ones and feel like their identity is shaken. May they see that their comfort in life and death is that they belong to Jesus Christ. We pray for those who suffer anxiety and depression. Again, what is the answer? The comfort is that we belong to Jesus Christ. We pray for those with serious and long-term consequences for COVID or other chronic illnesses and conditions. We pray for those who are homebound, who have to come in online, and some who can't anymore. We pray that we will be the church to them and that we'll continue to go and let them know that they are not forgotten. We pray for those who are dealing with cancer, for Fran, who is back in chemo treatment and who has now suffered a fall and who doesn't know why there's a lump on her back. Oh, Lord, our hearts, just like you, Jesus, were moved in compassion towards people that you met here on this earth. Our hearts are moved with compassion towards Fran and others. We pray for Denise, who has been such a hard worker for your kingdom and for this church, and who struggles to be able to see. We ask, O Lord, and continue to pray that you restore that vision, and although it looks as though no strides have been made, we trust you. We trust you and we pray because you tell us how and you tell us to pray. To your Father, we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We are studying in Sunday school how God is sovereign and he is the one who provides everything in an answer to his sovereignty and providence. Because nothing we have comes from us. All of it comes from him. May we give back with great joy because we have received the comfort in belonging to Jesus. We are created to glorify and enjoy him forever. Let us consider our giving and be generous in it because God is generous to us.
Thank you.
know if I've heard that piece before, Tracy. That's beautiful. Is that one of yours?
No, that's a new piece.
Okay, it's a new piece. Tracy, by the way, does write music. And I have told her, feel free to bring it and share it with us and let me know, because I'll let you know when it is. But I was thinking as you were playing that, it sounded to me like raindrops hitting the water. And I was thinking about in the context of what the scripture, sometimes Tracy doesn't know why God leads her to play certain music, but boy, we can experience it when you listen, and you do. Thank you so much, Tracy. It was beautiful, very beautiful. So let us pray. We are so grateful. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you that you have given us hands, that we might pick up the resources that you have provided and hold them out to you. And we ask that you consecrate them, that you bless them, that they might be blessings given to us for what we give to be blessings to all the nations. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. At the place of lifting together in unison our affirmation of faith. This has been one of the creeds that we are studying in Sunday school. You'll notice that it's in three paragraphs. We see God, the Father Almighty, I believe. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son. And finally, I believe in the Holy Spirit. So let us stand together as from the ancient Apostles' Creed, written for the time of the showing of our faith through water at our baptisms. Together, let us say in unison, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We were at a session meeting on Thursday. Do you remember Thursday? The rain nonstop all day. And I was teasing, look for an ark out there. We're going to hear about this on Sunday. But the rain has stopped. And look how beautiful the sun shines. And God had said after the time of Noah, anytime you see a rainbow in the sky, look through the congregation when the sun is coming through. There were rainbows all over Jim's sweater when he was sitting in the front. So keep an eye looking out for rainbows, and let us sing with great joy hymn 308, Love Lifted Me. and the comfort of knowing that you belong to Jesus Christ. Go with great joy and peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all good people who agree say, amen. Amen. God be with you. Beautiful Lord's Day. Enjoy the comfort of each other, too.